few years ago, a friend of mine, a grown adult, said to me,
"We had a war in Libya?"
And that's how it is in our era of phony wars now. We got so many we can't even keep track. You could have an entire year of war against a man who really was a global superstar, the wacky colonel Muammar Ghaddafi, a character that everyone was familiar with. Yet, for many Americans, apparently the whole thing slipped by without even being noticed at all. Low-level war continues to rage there. After the revolution in Egypt in early 2011, where the entire population of the country virtually came together to overthrow the longtime American-backed dictator Hosni Mubarak, the Americans needed a public relations stunt. Ronald Reagan had attacked Muammar Gaddafi back in the 1980s. In 1986, MI6, the British intelligence service, had attempted to use Libyan Islamic fighting group terrorists, bin Ladenite associates, to kill Gaddafi around 1999 and 2000, a policy that had failed and then was completely called off after September 11th. But George W. Bush had famously invited Gaddafi in from the cold in 2003. It was really a publicity stunt itself, in order to try to claim that the Iraq war was good for anything. See, Bush claimed, it scared Gaddafi into compliance, and he's now giving up his nuclear weapons program. In fact, he just had some junk left over from a Pakistani garage sale that was sitting in boxes in a warehouse and could never really have been used to create nuclear weapons. And he had truly bought that stuff just in order to have something to negotiate away and give the Americans a win so that they would invite him in from the cold. And that's what George Bush did. Gaddafi's government immediately joined the coalition against jihadist terrorists. In fact, his government had issued the first warrant, the international arrest warrant for Osama bin Laden back in 1996. He did have his enemies in the jihadist groups like the Libyan Islamic Fighting Group, many of whom who had traveled to Iraq War II to fight with Zarqawi against the Americans and the Shiites there. In the aftermath of Iraq War II, many of them came home, and as was abundantly clear at the time, the uprising in Libya wasn't really a bunch of scrappy democratic rebels at all. It was led by Libyan al-Qaeda members, veterans of Iraq War II. That was whose side Obama and Hillary took in that war. And by the way, they lied us into it. Just as Bill Clinton had claimed that 100,000 people had been killed in Kosovo in 1999, and George Bush had claimed that there were warehouses full of sarin and VX and all kinds of poisons and nerve gases and a nuclear program in Iraq. In Libya, Barack Obama had the lie that Muammar Gaddafi had vowed to murder every last man, woman, and child in the city of Benghazi, and that America had to intervene to stop a genocide from taking place. When, of course, Gaddafi could have killed every man, woman, and child in Benghazi his whole long dictatorship. For decades, he'd ruled that country and had never done any such thing. And in his government's effort to put down the uprising in the various towns where it had begun, they had not massacred civilians in any of them. They had simply put down the rebellion and had moved on to the next town. There was no real reason to believe that. This was a hoax that Barack Obama's government served up to the American people in order to make this seem like a defense of innocent life. And in fact, we know now that the military and the CIA were trying to stop the war, while Hillary Clinton's State Department was leading the charge for it. Another one of the famous lies of the war was that Muammar Gaddafi was passing out Viagra to all of his troops to rape their way across Libya and wage this total war of humiliation against the women of Libya in order to get democratic constituents on board. There were mass rapes in the Libya war, but it wasn't Gaddafi passing out Viagra. It was the jihadist militias that America had sided with, who waged a massive sectarian and ethnic cleansing campaign against sub-Saharan black Africans in Libya. The rumor essentially was that since Gaddafi had hired some black Africans as mercenaries in his private protection force, that therefore all blacks in Libya were somehow Gaddafi's mercenaries and were enemies of the state to be destroyed. And so the town of Tawerga was completely wiped off the map. Thousands of people were killed. and the women rounded up into refugee camps, where we have it on good authority, the great reporter David Enders, who was there and interviewed all these women, that the jihadists would come at night and participate in these mass gang rapes with American-supplied weapons held to these women's heads. The violence that the Obama administration promised that they were intervening to stop has reigned across Libya ever since then. Obama later famously said that Libya was a shit show and it was the worst mistake of his presidency. But if you look closely at his statement, he doesn't say he was wrong to take al-Qaeda's side in overthrowing a stable dictatorship in North Africa. He said his mistake was only that he did not invade and occupy the country with American infantry and embark on the kind of nation-building campaign that had already completely failed in Iraq leading up to this. The destabilization of Libya by Obama's war in 2011 has led to the rise of literal chattel slave markets being opened there, and of course has played a major role in the refugee crisis in Europe, opening up an ungoverned space for sub-Saharan Africans to attempt to cross the Mediterranean Sea and make it to Italy by the tens of thousands, and thousands of whom have died in the attempt, a crisis which continues to this day. And of course, this was a huge part of the war that then spread into the country of Mali in the Western Sahara, where the Tuareg's rebellion was quickly superseded and taken over by Libyan jihadists. And it's also, of course, the basis of Hillary Clinton's, quote, bank shot plan to smuggle jihadists and weapons from Libya onto the next regime change in Syria. The worst scandal to come out of the Libyan war, the killing of Ambassador Stevens and some CIA officers on September 11th, 2012, is actually a limited hangout. There wasn't enough security. The military did not swoop in and perform a rescue on time. They blamed the attack on a riot over a silly movie on YouTube, when in fact it was really a terrorist attack by al-Qaeda. Well, all those criticisms were true, but they missed the major point. What was Ambassador Stevens and the CIA doing in Benghazi? Why did they have a makeshift consulate in eastern Libya when the capital city, Tripoli, is in the west? And the answer is America and their allies, particularly the Qataris, were in the middle of a mission to funnel these jihadists and guns, especially those seized from Gaddafi's stores, on to the next war in Syria. They claim that these guys were monitoring the transfer of weapons. Yeah, they were participating in it. And so all of that outrage about the Benghazi attack, which then the liberals dismissed and the Democrats dismissed as just this Republican obsession that went nowhere, actually could have gone somewhere, somewhere very important. Except, of course, this policy of supporting the jihadists now, the veterans of Zarqawi's fight in Iraq War II included the leadership of the Republican Party in the United States, and most especially, Senator John McCain. Check out my writings at antiwar.com, my show at scotthorton.org, the Libertarian Institute at libertarianinstitute.org, and my books, Fool's Errand, Time to End the War in Afghanistan, and Enough Already, Time to End the War on Terrorism, at enoughalreadybook.net.